Okay, good afternoon, everyone. And we are excited to start our sharing today. We would like to share our experience about how we explore adopting reinforced learnings in Kubernetes Descheduling. My name is Haosong, and I will join with my colleague, Xuming. We are both engineers working in the engineering infrastructure at Shopee. Due to the visa issue, sorry for that, my colleague Xuming will share remotely instead of on-site. Before we get started, I would like to give a brief introduction about our company. We are from Shopee, which is an e-commerce company operating in several markets across the world. Today, we are the leading e-commerce platform in Southeast Asia, Taiwan, and Brazil. We are also the number one shopping app in these markets by average monthly active users, as well as total time spent in app. In Shopee, we have used Kubernetes to manage and orchestrate large numbers of pods that power in the backend systems behind Shopee. Today, we have over 100,000 pods run across tens of thousands of nodes, distributed across multiple data centers worldwide. And we expect these numbers to continue growing as the company grows in these years to come. For today's talk, Xuming will introduce the issues we encounter in Shopee scenarios and how we use the traditional way to address them. Then I will continue to share how we explore reinforced learning to address the problems we are encountered. At the end, I will also introduce the disadvantage of reinforced learning we found when we roll out it to production and how we plan to address in the future. Now, let me pass to Xuming to share his part.
Okay, thank you, Haosong. As we all know, Kubernetes assigns pods to certain nodes in a cluster through the Kubernetes scheduler. The scheduler's primary objective is to optimize resource utilization and ensure that the application runs smoothly and efficiently. Kubernetes scheduling is composed of two main phases, filtering phase and scoring. In the filtering phase, Kubernetes eliminates nodes that are not suitable for running a pod. It will filter out nodes that cannot provide enough resources for a pod request. In the scoring phase, Kubernetes assigns a scope to each remaining node based on various criteria, such as resource utilization, pod affinity, and node affinity. Kubernetes scheduling enables workload distribution, load balancing, and fault tolerance. It plays a vital role in optimizing resource allocation. But the result is a runtime optimal decision based on the current cluster resource topology. It doesn't adapt to changes in the cluster if a pod is running. After running a Kubernetes cluster in live environment for some time, we found that changes in the cluster resource status could cause the original efficient and optimized pod distribution to become less than ideal. This can lead to uneven workload distribution and inefficient resource usage. The reasons might include nodes are underutilized or overutilized. New nodes are added to clusters. Nodes hardware specifications have changed. Pod and node affinity requirements, such as times or labels, have changed, and the original or scheduling decisions are no longer appropriate for certain nodes. Different applications times adopt different overflow strategies and may even adjust on demand. Some pods managed by custom controller cannot be evaluated arbitrarily. The Descheduler project tries to solve the above problems. It provides an automated system for running rescheduling. The working mechanism of Descheduler primarily resolves around a set of policies that define when and how to reschedule pods within the cluster. Here is the basic workflow of the Descheduler. First, Descheduler begins by inspecting the current state of the cluster, including the resource usage of nodes, as well as the distribution of pods across them. Then, based on predefined policies, the descheduler determines which pods should be rescheduled. For instance, if a node is overload and there is a policy to handle overload nodes, the scheduler will mark some pods on the node for rescheduling. Once pods have been marked for rescheduling, the scheduler issues a relation command through the Kubernetes API. The Kubernetes scheduler finds new nodes for the awaited pods based on the current state of the cluster and rescheduling process. Finally, the descheduler is typically set to run at regular intervals to ensure that the cluster continuously maintains an optimal state. It is important to note that the scheduler does not direct move a pod from one node to another, but rather it reads the pod. Pods are still scheduled by Kubernetes scheduler. In practice, we found the resource utilization of most clusters have been significant improvement, but the descheduler was not working as well as we expected. The major deficiencies: one, complex configuration. The powerful capabilities of the descheduler depend on a series of complex process configurations. This could pose configuration and management challenges for administrators, especially in large-scale and complex environments. Two, some pods are erected too frequently. The same specific pods are likely to be erected repeatedly, and they may even return to their original nodes after eviction. This is because the decision on whether the node capacity is balanced just based on the pod request, without considering the actual workload of the nodes. Three, inability to handle certain types of pods. There are certain types of pods, such as daemon set, clone set, emplacement pods, that the descheduler cannot handle. Four, potential for service interruptions. The descheduler erected pods may lead to temporary service interruptions, especially if pod disruption budgets are not correctly configured. We need to find new ways to further improve resource utilization while maintaining capability. Okay, let my colleague Haosong introduce how we try to solve this problem through the reinforcement learning method. Thank you.
Thank you, Xuming, for your introduction to about descheduling in Shopee scenarios. While rule-based descheduler achieve outstanding results in these scenarios, addressing our specific problem effectively, we are curious about potential more efficient methods. With the rise of AI, we are exploring whether machine learning technologies can enhance scheduling efficiency. Reinforced learning, in particular, has been widespread applications in scheduling research in recent years. But what is reinforced learning, and why is it suitable for scheduling? If we categorize scheduling machine learning algorithms by objective, they are fall into two main groups: prediction tasks and decision-making tasks. Prediction tasks include, for example, use the AI to determine if images contain a human face, or large language model like ChatGPT predict the next token based on the previous input. Decision-making tasks, on the other hand, involve training as an agent to autonomously making decisions to achieve a goal, such as playing games. This diagram illustrates how reinforced learning makes decisions and take actions. In this framework, we refer to the training target as the agent. The agent learns policies during training. It observes the state and the environments, taking action based on the observation, trigger environment changes, and receive new states and rewards in response. The agent continually improves its policies, taking actions, then alter the environments and garner new rewards. This process repeats until the agent maximizes rewards. We will encounter several terminology commons in reinforced learning, such as agent, state, environment, action, and reward. This tense has specific meanings in the context, which we will explore in later sliders. In reinforced learning, a popular algorithm by training target is Q-learning. It utilizes a Q-table to maintain state-action transitions. This is effective for low-dimension data. However, with high-dimension data, tabular methods falter. With the rise of deep learning, in past decades, there has been a shift towards integrating it with reinforced learning, deep Q-learning. For instance, employing neural network to learn and store policies, a sufficiently deep and large-scale neural network can model complex and data relationships, even with numerous dimensions. Reinforced learning has proved it successful in various applications over the year. The most notable work is AlphaGo, developed by Google DeepMind, which defeated top human Go players and showcased the amazing capabilities of AI. Other famous application is autopilot systems for the electronic cars. Brands like Tesla utilize reinforced learning to control speed and steering, adapt to diverse situations. Given its power and proved success across industry, can reinforced learning be applied to scaling challenges? After receiving recent research, the answer is definitely yes. Scaling problems can align well with the Markov decision process, an area where reinforced learning is good. Significant research, such as Google DeepMind, published as 8 years ago, has adopted reinforced learning for complex scheduling tasks like multiple resource diamond packing, achieved state-of-the-art results compared to the previous heuristic algorithms. Various academic institutions have published numerous papers in this field, falling into different categories based on the methods of implementation. One approach is to use the agent trained as the reinforced learning as a scheduler to direct resource allocation and management. Another approach involves use the agent as a stage selector, choosing the most appropriate loop-based scheduler based on the current situation. In our case, we adopt the first method, enable the scheduler to handle multiple dimension data at the same time. Now that we have decided our approach, let's discuss how to implement it in Kubernetes de-scaling. The process may be straightforward, with only 4 steps to apply reinforced learning to Kubernetes de-scaling. Define the problem, implement the reinforced learning algorithm, training the agent, and then deploy it to production. However, there's a catch. We find there's no existing work on applying reinforced learning specifically in Kubernetes de-scaling. While there are many studies on using reinforced learning in general scheduling problems, none are directly applicable to Kubernetes or de-scaling in particular. Thus, we have to develop our solutions from scratch without relying on the previous work. The first step is problem definition. It's crucial to clearly understand the problems we are addressing, as this will significantly influence all our reward functions designed in later stage. In the context of Shopee, we have identified our objective is to achieve balance across the cluster. The next step is to qualify what constitutes balance or imbalance across the clusters. To measure the imbalance of the workloads across the cluster, we use the variance of the load. A higher variance indicates a greater imbalance. The ideal variance is zero, signifying even load distribution. We use the changes in variance as a reward signals during training. If the variance decreases after agent's action, it receives a positive reward, reflecting a more balanced state than before. Since the agent learned to maximize cumulative rewards, this guides it towards policy that enhance the cluster balance. The reinforced learning define the action and observation space explicitly is essential. The action space includes all potential actions the agent may take. In our agent de-scaling scenarios, we define it as a pair comprising of a container and a worker node. The observation space include all possible states the agent may observe. For this grain, this means it being aware of resource allocation and usage across the cluster. We represent this user matrix that includes each worker node's allocation and usage states. The allocation and usage states for each workload also can be further detailed to include every container's resource allocations and usage. This comprehensive observation allows our agents to accurately assess the state of each containers in each node, enable more precise actions based on its observations. Having defined the essential components of a reinforced learning problem, we can now begin our implementation. There are several mature libraries available for this purpose, such as Babel-Base3. We will utilize two popular libraries widely used in reinforced learning. The first is Skin, created by OpenAI, which we will use to implement a custom environment that interacts with the Kubernetes cluster. The second is RayILib, which provides a lot of ready-to-use reinforced learning algorithms. Recall the concepts of the environments in reinforced learning. We need an environment that interacts with the agent. From the agent, they learn policies. But how does Kubernetes cluster interact with the agent? To facilitate this interaction, we use the GIN to implement an adapter, creating a bridge between the agent and the Kubernetes cluster. When creating a custom environment in GIN, key interface need defining. The most critical is the state method. The state method receives actions from the agent, then return the new states and rewards after applying the action of the environments. This is where the most of the logic is implemented. The other method, reserve and render, are used for environment initialization and visualizing the agent states. After implementation of these custom environments, we proceed to implement these reinforced algorithms using RayILib. The first, we register our custom environments. Then we select appropriate training algorithms with specific configurations and hyperparameters. We also define the process for training the agent with the chosen reinforced learning algorithm. You may notice that we use PPO to training our agent. PPO, or Proximal Policies Optimization, is created by OpenAI as well. ChatGPT also employs PPO in its fine tuning, known as reinforced learnings from human feedback, to better align the response with human preference. We explore the other reinforced learning algorithms like SAC, but PPO's training process proved more stable and yield better results more easily. PPO also used an actor-critic architecture, means it training two neural networks. The policy net defines actions based on the given state, while the very net estimate the accumulated values from the state and the action, provide feedback to the policy net. These networks are trained together. Each will improve the other. This method balances the advantage of policy net and very methods, leading to better convergence and the ability to learn stochastic policies. Compared to other actor-critic algorithms, PPO introduced clipping mechanisms and Colbert-Liberal divergence to prevent overly large policy updates. These mechanisms balance exploration and exploitation, resulting in better performance and stability. PPO also used generalized advantage estimations to estimate the various balance bias and variance, leading to more effective learning and more stable policy updates. For training, we use KubeRay, a Kubernetes operator that simplifies deploying a manager Ray in Kubernetes. KubeRay can distribute Ray's worker logouts across multiple Kubernetes pods. Different pods are trained in a distributed concurrent manners with various hyperparameters. Upon completion, we select the best checkpoints from the training histories. The training initial results looks good with the training converging over episode. However, some agents still exhibit slightly overfittings or underfittings toward to the end. So how we address it? One approach is to continue fine-tuning the hyperparameters of the PPO algorithms to balance the exploration and exploitation. Hyperparameters like learning rate, clip parameters, batch size, and entropy coefficients all have different impacts on the training outcomes. Race official documents provide more details on these effects. A useful trick is to leverage it to rate 10 API, which allow us to greatly research the exploration within a range of hyperparameters and combinations. Within Kubernetes, the process is distributed across multiple Kubernetes pods for concurrent trainings, enable more efficiency and easier identifications of the best hyperparameters. In addition to the hyperparameters tuning, we also can consider changing the backbone network of our reinforced learning model. Our PPO implementation currently uses a fully connected network, but other research also experiment with the convolutional neural network, low short-term memory networks, or transformer. The truth depends on the nature of the observation space. For instance, if the input is the images, a convolutional neural network may be more appropriate. To exploit the convergence, we also can adjust the definitions of our rewards and action space. This to enable more efficient policies explorations by the agent. For instance, pulling the invalid actions can prevent the agent from learning incorrect policies. Additionally, including penalties into the reward systems can deter the agent from learning undesirable behaviors. During the training, we also noticed interacting with the actual Kubernetes cluster and waiting for messages to update from the monitoring systems for each episode was too slow. To accelerate this, we developed a Kubernetes scheduler simulator. This simulator goes through the scheduling process without actually launch port, similar to the K-walk. This approach doesn't require setting up a full-size cluster and still allow us to simulate the entire process for policy learning. It also reduced the risk of the agent disrupting the Kubernetes cluster during training. Note that since we don't create a real pod for the simulator, we use random usage data flowing a normal distributions as part of the observation space. This prevents the training an unstable agent with empty data from the monitoring system. Finally, we obtain a stable checkpoints that meet our requirements without overfitting or underfitting. Yeah, here is an example demonstrate the descheduling process during this checkpoint. You can see the cluster usage distributions become more balanced as the descheduling process become to evade a pause. So it seems to work, right? So we consider deploying to production. However, our SIE teams raised several concerns about the descheduler and rejected the rollout. Their concerns is quite valid. For example, they point out the neural network is a black box with the behavior that are hard to predict and evaluate in worst case scenarios. They also express concerns about the new system's typical has more bugs and question how we can issue a proper downgrade if the reinforced learning's approach failed. This leads to us to reflect our implementations on reinforcement learning scheduler. Indeed, it introduced additional risks for our users. After several rounds and discussions with our SR team, we designed a safe deployment stage. As shown in this diagram, we run both reinforced learning scheduler and rule-based scheduler concurrently. We add extra components to evaluate and select the best checkpoint, scheduling decisions from both. We also set up a system to reject invalid scheduling requests. If the reinforced learning disk drive become unstable or crash, we automatically forbid to the loop-based disk drive. This approach gives us room to improve our reinforced learning disk area while issue the stability of our Kubernetes clusters. After deployment, we collect the data on the disk scaling trajectories for both disk scaling and compare their difference to identify the issues with the new reinforced learning disk area. This helps us improve our reinforced learning algorithms when training the agents for better future performance. Now we have deployed our new reinforced learning disk area to a production cluster with 100 nodes. Moving forward, we plan to expand its coverage. However, there are still rooms for the improvements. Currently, the initial parameter scores search during agents training is quite time consuming. We are exploring the use of imitation learnings to reduce this. We also see some research in these areas haven't applied to our trainings. Other areas could be improved is state-of-the-art framework to continuously utilize production data. We also plan include service SLA and other dimension in the observation and reward space. As our cluster serve various service with different latency SLA sensitive. As we expand to more production clusters, we aim to accommodate this need and issue our disk area satisfy the scenarios. We also consider replacing the backbone of neural network to attention-based neural network to see whether we can achieve better performance. Okay, that concludes today's presentation. Thank you all for your attending. The day after tomorrow, we will have another session that use machine learning for time series forecasting to optimize resource utilization and reduce cost. You can check it out by scanning the QR code here. And looking forward to meet everyone there again. Thank you again for your attendance today. Okay.